will travel at 80 to 100 kilometers an hour for passenger safety. The committee says maglevs are a big improvement over subways and light rail.
But you haven't really seriously gone into cost cutting. And I don't know what the answer is. And if you would have had these things come up, and if it was true as alleged that Mr. Horner was not even aware of this, then where does that leave the public in trying to get accurate, truthful, transparent information?
Wherever you may be, go ahead and drop us a call and toll free at 1-888-565-8383. Log on to our website, khvhradio.com, and we'll connect. Have a great time. Also on Facebook, KHVH News Radio Honolulu. All right, there's no doubt about it, dating back to, I guess, you know, the beginning of time, that we have had the rail issue as a centerpiece of this program. And, you know, my position on it, it's fairly simple. But there has been somewhat of a dearth of information, at least that has been publicized in our major media here at home. With the exception of a couple of intrepid reporters, Malia Zimmerman, who has departed to Los Angeles, unfortunately, but and also AP, Andrew Pereira, over at KITV. And you'll see some publicity and stories generated in Civil Beat. So I want to acknowledge that there are individuals and select agencies that are still interested in presenting as much of a picture as possible about rail. There are a few people in this community that have been involved and literally immersed in the rail issue than Tom Berg, former city council member, but now one of the clarion voices when it comes to not only the status of this project, but more importantly, what the future will hold. So it's good to have Tom in studio with us. It's been quite a while, and Tom, thanks for being with us here today. We wish you aloha. And let's see, let's make sure
good morning.
Right there. Okay.
Aloha. Thank you for having me.
How you been?
Fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah, you look awesome.
So do you.
Goodness gracious. I think collectively we've lost about 3,800 pounds. It's amazing. Yeah. Tell us what, Tom, let's start a little bit and set the table for our friends, if you wouldn't mind. Rail, your opposition to this project is steeped in, began with, what was a catalyst for you and your tremendous involvement in this issue?
It was the technology. It was to be at the onset told that the decision to choose steel wheels on steel rails, the only thing modern about it is it's driverless. Otherwise, you have a locomotive.
Mm-hmm.
And when Leningrad, Russia, is advancing urban maglev technology, Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, maglev technology, NASA has partnered with Skytran in five countries, and they're advancing it in Tel Aviv right now. So if we talk about right here at home in our own country, we have Orlando, Florida, advancing on a fixed elevated guideway of 13 miles, some eight stations, $400 million totality to construct that project. The rest of the world is advancing a different type of rail system than our steel wheels. My objections were not to stop rail, so to speak, but in wanting to come on your radio program today and engage with your listeners, was that if we examine this, we the people have never been afforded with the opportunity to tell the federal government. We haven't been able to come to the table and assess or reassess how we are paying for this project. Can we come to the table? And our own local government doesn't want us there, is not letting us participate. So my frustration was to examine, go into triage, so to speak, of the full funding grant agreement and re-examine what was offered to us.
Mm-hmm.
So you can imagine when I got into the council in December of a special election of 2010, it was right after Governor Lingle released her scathing report on the
independent report.
Independent.
Right.
See, the city had advanced numbers that were not accurate on its face value, and it's proven truthful. So what the listeners would want to talk about or engage with is at this time that we're at with Senate Bill 19 and other mechanisms to further this tax upon us for the rail, do we want to advance a technology where it was just revealed, Rick, in December of 2014, that the Waianae Coast cannot be served by this rail technology that we're advancing, with only 5% physically up on the landscape?
Mm-hmm.
Why would we, in good faith, the rest of the island, say to our friends on the Waianae Coast, oh, by the way, all this money going into this rail project of steel wheel can't get over the hill. We're going to have to use rack-assisted, we're going to be cranking mm-hmm. this thing over the hill and have to merge two different type of technologies. Wouldn't you rather the voters, the taxpayers, have a uniform system that's in line with the rest of the world? So I just see it that when Leningrad made the switch, they have steel wheel for free in the junkyards available to them throughout that country, and they don't want to put any type of a steel wheel rail up. They've made the turn into the 21st century. So I could go on for hours, and cut me off, Rick, at any point in time.
No, I'm going to listen intently as long as along with everyone else. When the alternatives analysis were conducted at the outset, there were those that were already standing up and saying, first of all, unfair process. It's already a fait accompli. Decisions have already been made. There was no real consideration for what you're talking about, other types of technologies, managed lanes, whatever it might be, that it appeared from the outset that this was a done deal. Do you agree with that?
No. The federal government has in its administrative rules, and it doesn't have a name, so to speak, bylaws, the guide, however you want to reference it. But the federal government says we have to have strict guidelines in there. You have to have an operational date. You have to have your level of service. So the 21 miles, the 21 stations, 20.1 mile fixed guideway project, that is defined in the full funding grant agreement. What you just alluded to was that when the decision in 08 to proceed, my claim was that upon being elected, the city charter affords me as a council person at that time to put the choice to amend the charter to the people. The democratic process wasn't followed. The ping pong ball between the state legislature and executive branch and judiciary, it's meant to be that between the state and the county as well. So when the voters paying for this rail project were told on December 2nd of 2010 that on the low estimates, this was $1.7 million more than what the city had advanced. Now, everyone should raise an eyebrow that the city and county of Honolulu decided not to advance that report and make it inclusive to the Federal Transit Administration. That report was for the taxpayer, because it was paid for by the taxpayer. This wasn't from Governor Lingle's campaign account. We paid for this. Because the taxpayer paid for this analysis, on the high end of her analysis, it was roughly $9 to $10 billion. What the people should be most disturbed about coming forward to today's newspaper and how to piecemeal this project is one of the things I found most offensive while at the council. As soon as Hart came on board in July 1 of 2011, they had the opportunity to scrutinize a contract, which Ansaldo got, right, of mm-hmm. $1.4 billion. What every listener should know is that Ansaldo had the lowest numbers for construction. So if we're already at the high end and have exceeded the lowest numbers, remember this. Ansaldo's maintenance contract for O&M, operations mm-hmm. and maintenance, was the highest. So that hasn't kicked in. We're going to get the highest end of that. My point about Hart is that they haven't acted in good faith, that when they were apprised by Bombardier, a bidder, all mm-hmm. your listeners, I know this, haven't heard the following, what I'm about to say, is that when Bombardier advanced its case and the Office of Administrative Hearings and so forth with the appeals, the court, or rather in the process, would not allow Bombardier to bring evidence. It was only on procurement law. In other words, did they follow in the chapter of HRS this step? The answer was yes. That's why Bombardier lost at each stage. However, when it was all said and done, and what we knew in the council was that the procurement process of the bid had on one page a cap to indemnify the risk assessment. On the next page, it conflicted. Bombardier raised its hand and says, your procurement process will never fly. It's flawed. When they tried to help the city and county of Honolulu and engage, Bombardier got dismissed. Their bid came in at $241 million less. Had Hart been wanting to act in good faith on behalf of the taxpayers, they knew they already had a mechanism to rebid that for letting out when Bombardier said, we'll drop our case. It's available till October 31st. We are still $241 million less. So this whole insurance clause that the listeners need to know of is that when Bombardier, quote, lost, we the people lost. Because I said to myself, why isn't the city and county of Honolulu and the city council and mayor with Bombardier? Why aren't we helping and saying, these guys are coming in with a bid that will save us $240 million. So today's newspaper, 10, 50, 70 million here and there, that was a big chunk of change at the onset. So if we follow along when at the council, so in 2008, Councilmember Anderson's basically alluding to that, you know what, folks, for that four-year period we were locked in, the federal government says you can't change anything. That's an untruthful and a mischaracterization of those, again, administrative rules or bylaws that regulate full funding grant agreements. There's clauses and chapters in there that say if you have fiscal stress, financial, not stable, whatever it is, you need to let us know and we'll hold your hand and you won't get penalized, you won't forfeit anything, you won't go to the back of the line. We want you to succeed. So if you have a different rail system that costs less, but its level of service remains the same, its features remain the same, instead of putting a 8-foot pillar of cement in the ground, with 4-foot noise mitigation cement wall skirtings on the top of the guideway. That's a lot of money going into cement. Wow. If you went with urban maglev, for instance, urban magnetic levitation passenger rail, it's an 18-inch pillar, right? And there's no noise mitigation of cement needed because it doesn't emanate such noise. Thereby, hundreds and hundreds of millions. Everything would kick in, Rick, if we had the opportunity to reassess and activate and exercise our rights that the full funding grant agreement afforded us. If you were to eventually play the two-minute clip of Councilmember Anderson in 2011, he shuts down the people's right to react on Governor Lingle's analysis. So the public, the people, the voters on the hook for this bill to pay for rail were put in a predicament, Rick, and I'll end with this. On one side, you have your state government, you have your executive branch giving you numbers. On the other side, you have the city county of Honolulu giving you numbers, and they don't pan out. The arbitrator isn't the FTA or Congress. The arbitrator is the people, and the charter allows for any council member to change the so-called rail technology, steel wheel albeit. So that four-year period of 08 to when the full funding grant agreement was signed in December of 2012, we the people always had an option to exercise without penalty and amend that agreement, that contract.
Now, I'm going to play the clip because I want you to be a little more succinct and set this statement up that we're about ready to hear. Why don't you go ahead and do that
for us? This is November 2nd, 2011. As soon as I got into office, Rick, my polls, engagement with the kids, the schools, all said we want to vote. We don't want the steel wheel. So
I'm for a new vote.
My duty to
who else is for the new vote?
A measure.
You want to vote again?
Yes.
So this was to put rail.
How about you, doctor? You want a new vote? Brett Pine, want to vote again?
Ballot, no.
It would have been or any full funded grant agreement was to be executed later. So the decision of we the people to say steel wheel on steel rail, not into it. I'd rather have what the rest of the world's building. Here's Councilmember Anderson saying, you know what, folks? We forfeited our right, relinquished our right. We let it lapse. We have no right to change our technology in 2011.
Chairman, I've met with the Federal Transit Administration, who is our federal overseer on Honolulu's mass transit project in Washington, D.C., a number of times. I've asked the question of the FTA that if, for some reason, this body should place on the 2012 general election ballot a question regarding Honolulu's mass transit project. And if that question should be in conflict with the 2008 ballot question regarding steel on steel that passed, could we perhaps be in jeopardy of the federal government requiring Honolulu to reimburse the upwards of $200 million that the federal government has given us thus far for our project? The answer from the FTA was yes. They would come back to Honolulu and they would require us to repay every cent that they have given us thus far for this project. Mr. Chairman, that's a grave concern for me. And that's not a hypothetical, Mr. Chairman. That's a definitive. The federal government has assured me that if, in fact, a charter amendment like this passes, they will indeed come back and require us to repay them. That's not an assumption. It's a fact. It came from the FTA themselves. In light of that fact, Mr. Chairman, I'm unable to support this particular measure moving forward at this time. I think the implications are great. I believe that it's a certainty that the federal government will, in fact, require Honolulu and our taxpayers to reimburse them for the federal monies that have been expended on our project thus far. And, Mr. Chairman, those consequences will be dire to the people of the city and county of Honolulu. Therefore, Mr. Chairman, I will not be able to support this going forward at this time. Thank you.
Well, there's no mincing of words. I mean, he's very, very specific in exactly what his justification was. I need to take a minute, give us your reaction again, interpretation of exactly what just transpired. I'm way behind on a break, but I want to make sure that you have that opportunity right now, Tom, to sum up exactly what was stated by Councilmember Anderson.
This was on first reading. It never made it to a committee. They took and did a waiver and executed something that was very rare. They filed the measure.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we suspend Council Rule 18C to permit a motion to file to be made at this meeting instead of waiting until our next council meeting.
For the second?
I second the motion.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion, members? The motion
on the floor. So that the people cannot bring the said subject matter up for another year, that the full funding grant agreement would have been executed. That in of itself of a maneuver to take away from the people their ability, this was supposed to be then filed the next month so that the people could object to the city council's actions. They did it right there, Johnny on the spot, a waiver to the rules, and said, get this thing out of here so that nobody's discussing their options. That to me is why all of us need to rise up.
Was there any confirmation as to the statement saying, I spoke directly with? Was there any paper trail? Was there a memo? I hate to bring up emails with everything going
Nothing.
On. Nothing. Anything.
I asked on that day, Rick, November 2nd, 2011. Asked November 3rd for 3 years solid. I banged on the door. My staff banged on the door. We wrote everyone in the FTA. The FTA does not have the jurisdiction to come into Honolulu and handcuff anybody. It's up to us to advance to them of misrepresentation. So we have to, on our end, exercise due diligence. So whatever the federal government looks down upon us, the remedy is on our end.
That's absolutely true. But the other part, this is a very specific, defined, precise statement that the council member made.
And it's untrue.
I spoke to.
Yes. Tell us who.
I'd like to know.
And if he did mention a name, I'm not picking on Councilmember Anderson. He could have gotten misinformation, bad information. And maybe that's why the FTA won't respond to any phone calls, emails, letters. It didn't matter who from. The fact is that to the FTA, it says, Honolulu, I don't need to respond anyway. Because if you just read the rules, you've always had the right, the privilege to exercise, to change the scope of your project as long as your level of service was not decreased. You always have, and, you know, Judge Judy can figure it out from here. There was no ink on any document.
Yeah.
How could we be culpable for something if Congress didn't even get the request in 2011 from us, the people? How could there already play Councilmember Anderson and play arbitrator, the judge and jury, and already tell us some third party has said no when the deliberations are before Congress? Congress deliberates. The Federal Transit Administration does not rule unilaterally.
There is a tremendous amount of diligence you've put forth in communicating with the feds. We're going to get into that a little bit. We also want to have an opportunity for folks to drop a call. If you have any thoughts, comments, concerns, questions, now's the opportune time. Tom, if folks want to get in touch with you, what's the best way to do it?
TomBerg00@yahoo.com.
Back in a moment with more of the Rick Hamada program. 7:39 in the morning, we're back with former City Councilman Tom Berg, who is joining us today, and fortuitously so, with information that you may or may not know about. Here's the bottom line, is that the discrepancies, the potential illegalities, and definitely compromising positions that have emanated out of the rail project today, as indicated by even the comments that were made as we broadcast to you in the City Council where Tom served. Very curious, I'll just commit to that at this moment. But Tom, I know that there's also a legal aspect to all of this that you're involved with, and would you mind sharing a little bit about that with us, please?
If everybody says to themselves, when they remember their eighth grade civics class, that the process of a democracy is that when you get new information that may affect the situation, however it may be, we don't have time to define it, but in simplistic terms, when the governor's report was released, it triggered an exercise whereby we, the public, were then to be able to determine how we want to make a decision. We were never allowed an opportunity to make a decision. And if someone asked a Federal Transit Administrator and we said, you know, when Governor Lingle provided this analysis for us that showed and demonstrated that the city's numbers advanced to the Federal Transit Administration are flawed, what's your opinion, FTA? Did we have a right to revisit the governor's analysis and say, we have to find another way? Maybe there is a better way, but let's at least examine it. Did we have the right to examine it? According to Councilmember Anderson and the City Council, when the vote was 8-1, they filed this on first reading because we wanted to make sure that we showed the federal government that there was no lack of confidence. And in my opinion, that is very offensive to me, Rick, and every of your listeners should feel the same.
Should we choose to the revisit ones who this are, project in
it
any
should
way
feel
whatsoever,
a lack of confidence in all of this are the taxpayers.
On Honolulu's part for this project.
The federal government, whether they are confident in us, is not relevant. I am not concerned whether or not they're confident in what we're going to do. I want to make sure whatever the people are advancing in good faith has been fully exhausted. And at this stage, culminating with hearings today on this very subject matter, I'm hoping people look the legislative body in the eye and say, you're witnessing a broken treaty right before you. Are you going to be a party to the ink? Are you going to be a party to the ink that goes on something that you know has been advanced in bad faith? Because until the people have had an opportunity to weigh in on the discrepancies and the variances at such stage in time, we must go back to that point in time legally. To answer your question then legally, is that we were not given and afforded that opportunity because misinformation was conveyed that the federal government said, you can't react to the governor's report. You have no right. So if your state executive branch tells you the city's numbers are fudged and can prove it, you, the people, have no right. You've already forfeited your right back in 08 when you said you're doing steel wheel. That, Rick, to all your listeners on its face value, you got to be scratching your head. Why wouldn't the federal government want to work with us and say, you mean there's a better way?
At that time, back in 2011, obviously with your grave concern, was there anybody else on the council that expressed any concerns about the statements that were made? Subsequent to that, years as the years continued, Tom, was there any other agency, individual, representative, elected official, bureaucrat, whatever, that rose up and said, this is patently wrong?
Governor Lingle did. She signed the petition wanting another vote. She wouldn't sign off on the EIS. It wasn't because she was dragging her feet. It's because it was the prudent thing to do, because this is a 100-year-plus project that's going to be on our landscape. And to examine something thoroughly of to the degree that she did was not on her own accord. It was on our accord. And so if we want to dismiss everything that she as our governor did for us to alert us, we could still avert these tax measures today if we merely tell the state legislature, you know what, the city and county of Honolulu never gave the citizens, the voters, the opportunity to weigh on the state, our taxpayers, the general fund, the legislature. You should be concerned. This came from the state side. Do you want to advance a tax on the people knowing that this so-called broken treaty is going to be compounded further? Or do you want to provide relief for the people to say, let's examine, like I mentioned, the new technologies that are out there. I'm not pushing anything, whether it's BRT, reversible expressways, maglev, monorail. Everyone has something to offer. What are we afraid of?
We need another break. Before we do, you have been exhaustive in communicating with folks at the FTA. Teresa, or is it Therese McMillan, the administrator?
That's the one that recently engaged with the four council members who went to D.C. to ask the very question. Isn't it odd, Rick, that in 2011, as you heard, it was definitive, 100%, can't do it. And now, 2015, they need to do an emergency, expend our tax dollars, fly to D.C. and ask the exact same question. Now, the answer that they got extrapolated from FTA administrators was, you know what? Your contract that you signed in December of 2012 calls for steel wheel on steel rail, which again solidifies and substantiates my entire claim that up until 2012, you have the FTA in the news just in the last week with the four council members affirming that it wasn't until the contract was signed, you always, according to the rules, could have found and requested for a waiver, for a petition, or relief, like you're going to have to do on your operational date, because you can't meet that operational date that's in the contract. You're already going to have to do triage on this thing and ask for congressional support and approval.
The question that you pose, on what date did Honolulu forfeit its right to solicit the FTA and or Congress for the ability to petition for a waiver that includes an amendment to the FFGA to change one rail system with another rail system and not be penalized for pursuing that change? This question has been oft submitted, and apparently without a specific definitive response from the feds. Is that correct?
And again, yes, but it is because, in my opinion, they're looking at us and saying it's your venue, it's your jurisdiction, it's your interaction internally. You have home rule. If you guys in your charter says your city council can put it up to a vote, which they can today, and you got nine council members that won't put it up to a vote, you should be disgusted.
Yeah.
If you got 76 legislators, a few of them are voting no on this thing. Good for them. But if you got an advancement of this, is that I look at it again. Boy, 150 years ago, if I were alive, 200 years ago, how would I have engaged on a broken treaty? What would have I had done? Would I want to rectify it? And we all talk about in the history books, wow, this was a bad deal. Somebody didn't pan out good for them. Well, it's happening right now before our very eyes. Why isn't it that all of us are saying this is a bad treaty? In other words, who's getting the bad deal? Every taxpayer is getting the bad deal.
Former City Councilman Tom Berg in studio with us. Tom, to contact you again, how do we do so?
Hey, I'd appreciate it if anybody would like to contact me at tomberg00@yahoo.com, please.
We'll take a short break. We'll come back. I encourage you, if you have any thoughts, questions, comments, observations, would like to chat with Tom or at least give your reaction to the information that you've been presented so far. We'll open up some time in the final moments that we have together with Tom Berg in studio here on News Radio 749. Our time is coming to an end with Tom Berg, but we do want to make sure that Dennis from the Big Island, Dennis, thank you for your call. You're on with Tom Berg. Good morning to you, Dennis.
Thank you so much, and thank you for all your work and presenting the light of day on this rather big train wreck about to happen. And thank you, Tom, for your work. And please keep it up. Unfortunately, this is only a symptom of what's going on in our nation today. And it's all about drugs. And the drug is money. And the pusher is the government, either local, state, or federal. And until the population of Hawaii and the rest of our country wakes up and realizes that we cannot afford what we don't have money for, no matter how great it is, we will pay dearly in the future, and the country will die because of it. You can't print money out of nothing, and we must, as citizens, realize no matter how great a program is, if we don't have the money, we must not do it. We can't do it at home, we can't do it locally, we can't do it statewide, and we can't do it federally.
We do appreciate it. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dennis. Right on point. Tom, thoughts?
Again, this broken treaty is that the caller is absolutely correct. In 2012, when the full funding grant agreement was signed, we had already done a $450 million line of credit that was never to be parlayed. We raised the debt service ceiling, never to be parlayed. We took transit operations from 11-18%, never to be parlayed. And then Governor Lingle in her report in 2010 says, nice try, guys. Your hundreds of million dollars in rating from the federal bus funds ain't going to pan out. Guess what? 5 years later, the council got caught with its hand in the cookie jar trying to do the same, and it ain't going to fly again. So guess what? They've got that small little contingency of a few hundred million to pay back off that they've taken from the bus. But the caller is absolutely correct, is that when the full funding grant agreement was brokered, it had morphed into so many different variables that it all really boils down to one simple thing. Do we or do we not have the right to weigh in? Right now, the legislature is bargaining with the counties, and you and I and all the listeners, Rick, are not at the table, and there's something wrong with this picture.
Mm-hmm. No doubt about it. We do have time for another call. One's coming in, but I want to make sure that folks understand where we are today. You mentioned before about hearings. There is also movement in regard. Now, is there a lawsuit that's going to be filed, Tom? Is that what the next logical step is for you?
In my opinion, if the legislative body, which they have subpoena powers, the Senate, needs to ask Councilmember Anderson to disclose a source, before they advance any kind of attacks, that would be the first relief I would ask in any kind of a lawsuit. Yes.
We're going to go to Glenn in Kaka'ako. Glenn, we have some time with Tom Berg. Glenn, good morning.
Good morning. I have a question. In simple terms, did the city council advance so that there's the allowance to increase the cost of rail?
The city council gets two budgets every year from the Honolulu Authority for Rapid Transportation, HART. One's the CIP budget, capital improvement projects. The other one's operation. And if you recall, when they said HART was to come on board in 2010, it wouldn't cost you anything. Well, their budget's just $22 million to rent the building, basically, and turn on the lights. So the answer is that monetary expense in any form or fashion goes to the city council. They hold the purse strings. If you recall Carlisle at the time, the mayor, it was a veto back and forth of an override. The mayor says, no, let HART, they can do what they want, give them a blank check. We, the people, won. The council voted 9-0, overrode the mayor, says, look, if HART's going to be a runaway train, there's got to be some way to slow them down. And that's when this comes up this spring, when the budget comes up. If you don't like what HART's doing, we could stop it at that venue as well.
One of the things Mayor Carlisle did say, it doesn't matter about federal money. It doesn't matter. We're doing this thing. It doesn't matter. I remember that. Tom, it's been one heck of a visit. I'd like for you, in about 30 seconds, put a little bow on our conversation. Last message to our listeners.
We've never given up the right. We never forfeited our abilities. We never relinquished or let anything lapse, folks. All we have to do is let everyone out there know who's a policymaker. We want a seat at the table. Let's ask for it, and let's get there, and let's sit down. And let's all parlay and get a better rail system for all of us.
Contact info again, Tom?
TomBerg00@yahoo.com.
Many thanks for taking the time today,
thank
Tom.
Thank you.
Thank you very, very much indeed. And we'll continue with more of the Rick Hamada program coming up after the top of the hour. And again, contact Tom for more information, and we'll be sure to disseminate it here. We'll be back right after Fox News.
Pan out, and guess who eats it? and makes up the difference, the taxpayer. And so at this time, I'm going to conclude with, there's no mechanism in here. There's no language. I know you can't hold future councils accountable for this, but there should be something in here that says, we guarantee there'll be no property tax. None. There will absolutely, once you go down on this, there will be no coming back and raising property taxes. And if you don't know and you're not sure, then this isn't a good deal. Because right now, I think it's more important we be able to flush our toilet, pay that sewer EPA mandate, and that's the issue at hand. This is a nice-to-have project, and if it were monorail, if it were maglev, it'd be a third of the price. We could go to UH Waikiki. It would be a better bang for your buck. But the steel wheel, steel rail, archaic behemoth, noisy, is not the solution. So when I first saw rail, I saw this go
downhill
fast.
Thank you, Councilmember Burr. Thank you, Councilmember
Burr. Vote no.
We know your position. Any further discussion, members?
The reason maglev, I don't think, advanced is there was no one here pitching it and selling it. Nobody's going to make a buck off it. Because it's the right thing to do for the taxpayer.
So it's being done. It's just not being done here. And there's no reason why we can't do this. This is America. There's no reason why the future of travel should lie somewhere else beyond our borders.
Well, why isn't Hart saving Honolulu a ton of money by using 21st century technology versus 19th century steel and steel rail, which is going to drive the city bankrupt?